we are going to mainly concentrate on the unit 4 electromagnetic waves and unit 5 on small topic guided waves and waveguide theory. Okay, so first we will go inside the first slide. So first slide tells us about a brief introduction about the entire unit of transmission lines and waveguide. So our entire unit of transmission lines is based on the frequency spectrum. So if you see, the first unit talks about the low frequency transmission line, where we are talking about the distorted line, how a distorted line can be converted into a distortionless line, and a small example taken as a telephone cable. And the second unit talks about your radio frequency, which is called as your high frequency transmission line. And in that we have talked about the dissipation, what are the voltage and current parameters of a dissipation and a dissipationless line, and input impedance. So these are the things what we have already seen about our unit 1 and 2. And unit 3 talks specifically about a very good application of our transmission line. So in our unit 1 and 2, we used to say the one of the main application of the transmission line is to transfer the energy or any form of information from one place to another. Apart from this particular application, the transmission line can also be used for certain very important applications, such as used as a transformer, isolator, insulator. In that case, in that particular line, one of the very important applications is impedance matching. So if impedance matching is achieved, one can see for maximum power being transferred inside a transmission line section. Okay, so our fourth and fifth unit talks about our ultra high frequency. So now if you see in this particular frequency spectrum diagram, at the bottom, the frequencies are being mentioned. That is from very low frequency, 3 kilohertz, to extra high frequency, that is 300 gigahertz. Okay, so here above that particular line of frequency, you can also see the wavelength lines, that is starting from 100 kilometer to 1 millimeter. So normally, all the high frequency, ultra high frequency waves are called as our short waves. What is the reason they are called as short waves? What do you mean by short waves? So that answer you can see in this particular diagram. So if you see here clearly, as the frequency goes on increasing, the wavelength goes on decreasing. So for example, if you see here at 300 megahertz, the wavelength is seen as 1 meter. At 30 gigahertz, the wavelength is seen as 1 centimeter. So what is the relationship between this frequency and wavelength? We already know the relationship. Wavelength lambda is equal to C by F. Wavelength is inversely proportional to frequency. As the frequency increases, the wavelength goes on decreasing. So at a very, very high frequency, like ultra high frequencies, when the frequency is very high in the range of gigahertz and terahertz, the wavelength is seen to be in centimeter or millimeter or nanometer. That is why the word short waves, shorter wavelength at high frequency, is always mentioned in all the applications. Now let us see a quick recap what is needed for our unit 4. So since we are going to see about the concepts of our waveguide, a simple application in the unit 4, which we call it as parallel plane wave. So what are the requirements to understand that concept is what we are going to see as a review of wave equation. So already you would have studied in your field theory concept about the Maxwell's equation. Okay, so whatever be the problem that is given in your hand regarding your electromagnetic field theory, the only solution that can be obtained is by solving your Maxwell's equation. Without Maxwell's equation, we cannot get any answer for the problem what is given in your hand. Okay, so here if you see in this slide, I have mentioned all the equations of our Maxwell's equation. So Maxwell's equation means it consists of 4 important equations. The first important equation is called as modified Ampere's law. The modified Ampere's law is represented as del cross H. We call it as del cross H, which is equal to J plus dou D by dou T, where that H is called as, you already know, it is called as magnetic field intensity. J is called as your current density, and D is called as your electric flux density. Okay, and there is a standard formula for D also. D is always represented as epsilon into E. That epsilon is called as your permittivity, and epsilon is a constant. That is why in the first equation, if you see, the J is replaced with the standard formula sigma into E. Sigma is called as conductivity and E is called as the electric field intensity. And the capital D, what we call it as electric flux density, is replaced with the standard formula epsilon into E. Epsilon is called as your permittivity and E is called as your electric field intensity. So the Maxwell's first equation is called as your modified Ampere's law. What is that modified Ampere's law? The electromotive force around a closed path produces a current density, that is J, and a magnetic displacement, that is denoted as capital D, throughout the surface bounded by the path. So del cross H is equal to J plus dou D by dou T. That is the Maxwell's first equation. Maxwell's second equation is del cross E equal to minus dou B by dou T. What is E? E is called as electric field intensity and B is called as magnetic flux density. So that B, the standard formula is mu into H, where mu, you already know, mu is called as your permeability and H is called as your magnetic field intensity. Okay, so the second Maxwell's equation is del cross E equal to minus dou B by dou T. B is replaced with the standard formula mu into H. Since mu is a constant, it comes out of the derivative. So it is written as minus mu dou H by dou T. So understood? So the two important Maxwell's equation are, first one is your modified Ampere's law, del cross H equal to J plus dou D by dou T. And second one is modified Faraday's law, that is called as del cross E equal to minus dou B by dou T. And the third Maxwell's equation is represented as del dot D equal to rho. This rho is called as your charge density. In the previous equation number one, if you see, the J is called as current density. Here the rho is called as your charge density. So normally, if you see, for a non-conducting medium like free space or whatever it be, our vacuum, the charge density is always assumed to be equal to zero because no current passes or propagates through a vacuum. So what happens? Sigma becomes zero. So this rho or J, whatever it be, it will become zero. So the third Maxwell's equation, del dot D equal to rho, is called as the Gauss law. And the fourth Maxwell's equation is del dot B equal to zero. That is, the magnetic flux density around a closed surface is always assumed to be zero. So have you understood? The four Maxwell's equation are, the first one is del dot del cross H equal to J plus dou D by dou T, del cross E equal to minus dou B by dou T, del dot D equal to rho, and del dot B equal to zero. So whatever be the electromagnetic problem that is given in your hand, always the first step is writing these four Maxwell's equation and trying to solve it. That will lead you to the proper answer what is needed for that particular problem. Okay, so next is, before going inside our unit 4 topic, that is parallel plane wave, the important topic, one should know what is a uniform plane wave called as. What is a uniform plane wave? Inside a two plane or parallel running plane, uniformly in all the direction, a wave will be allowed to propagate. Okay, so why this study of uniform plane wave is very, very important? So when you go for ultra high frequency and waveguides, you need to understand what is a electromagnetic wave propagation, in which direction the wave is propagating, how the energy is being scattered in the various direction, and what is the amount of radiation that is carried by that particular electromagnetic wave. So when you go to your electromagnetic waves, the energy, the information, or the whatever be the energy, is carried by means of the electromagnetic energy. So in order to understand the electromagnetic energy and the E and H field, one should know what is a uniform plane wave. That is why we are first seeing a basic concept of what is a uniform plane wave. So there are few properties for a uniform plane wave. So what is the important properties of a uniform plane wave is, normally in your waveguide, whatever be the waveguide, whether it is a rectangular waveguide or a square waveguide, it will be always kept at the center of a Cartesian coordinate system, or we can also call it as a rectangular coordinate system. I think you should be familiar with the word Cartesian coordinate system and the rectangular coordinate system from your electromagnetic field theory subject. Okay, So according to the Cartesian coordinate system, the coordinate system consists of three directions. What are the three direction? It is your x direction, y direction, and your z direction. In that Cartesian coordinate system only, your parallel plane wave or whatever be the electromagnetic waveguide will be placed at the center. So according to uniform plane wave, one should always remember two things. The direction in which the wave is propagating, in that direction, the components will not be existing. So it is similar to your thumb rule. So if you take your thumb rule, meaning you will keep your hand like this. So this thumb represents the direction in which your wave is propagating. The pointing finger represents the direction of your electric field, and your middle finger represents the direction of your magnetic field. So in the direction of propagation of the wave, if you keep like this, if you see like this, to the direction of propagation, your E and H fields are perpendicular with respect to each other. That is why normally we used to use the word transverse. The electric and the magnetic field, which are present in a particular direction of propagation, will be perpendicular with respect to each other based on the Thumb's rule. Okay, so that is what we have mentioned here. In a uniform plane wave, along the x direction, if it is assumed that the wave is propagating, along that direction, the component does not exist. The components will be existing in a direction perpendicular to that. So its effect will be present in the remaining two directions. Okay, understood? So uniform plane waves are transverse. You have to remember that. And uniform plane waves will be having all the components in E and H. For example, I said, no, now you are going to keep a waveguide in a Cartesian coordinate system. In a Cartesian coordinate system, you have three directions, X, Y, and Z. Along the X direction, you have the electric and magnetic field, and it is represented as E suffix X and H suffix X. Along the Y direction, you have your electric and magnetic field. It is denoted as EY and HY. Along your Z direction, you have your electromagnetic field, and it is represented as your EZ and HZ. So along all the three directions, always two components will be there. That is, your electric and magnetic field components will be there in all the three directions. Okay. So what is our uniform plane wave saying? In the uniform plane wave, the electric and magnetic fields are transverse, meaning in which direction the wave is propagating, in that direction, the components does not exist. Okay. So let us go to the slide number uniform plane wave. So in that uniform plane wave, we have talked about our concept of the uniform plane wave. So one should remember, for uniform plane wave, electric and magnetic fields will be transverse. In which direction the wave is propagating, in that direction components does not exist, but its effect will be present in the remaining two directions. So let me take it as an example and go to the next slide. So what is the direction if your wave is propagating? Along the y direction, one should always remember. Okay, so now next slide is talking about the relationship between your E and H components for a uniform plane wave. So this relationship everyone is familiar with. So what is the relationship between E and H? So E by H is equal to root of mu by epsilon. E by H is equal to root of mu by epsilon. So what is that concept known as? So E by H equal to root of mu by epsilon means mu is called as permeability and epsilon is called as permittivity. So that mu can be written as mu naught into mu r, epsilon can be written as epsilon naught into epsilon r. Okay, so for a free space or a vacuum, your relative permeability and permittivity will be equal to 1. So if you substitute the values of mu naught and epsilon naught, which is a standard value, 4 pi into 10 power minus 7 in the 8.854 into 10 power minus 12, you get the ratio for root of mu by epsilon to be 377 ohms or 120 pi. Okay, so always you have to remember E by H is equal to a standard formula root of mu by epsilon, which is equal to eta. Eta is called as your intrinsic impedance. Okay. So shall we continue? So E by H is equal to root of mu by epsilon, which is equal to intrinsic impedance, that is given by standard formula. So for always in 2 mark question, they will ask you what is the relationship between your electric field, magnetic field and your intrinsic impedance. So the relationship between all these three components is E by H equal to eta, which is equal to root of mu by epsilon, always given by a standard formula. 7 ohms are 125. Okay, so next one is, as a gist, we will talk about the uniform plane wave and go into the very, very important topic, parallel plane wave. So what is that we have seen in uniform plane wave? It will always propagate in any one direction, either in x direction or y direction or z direction. In which direction it is propagating, there the field will not be existing. So in x direction it is propagating, Ex and Hx will be zero. If in y direction it is propagating, Ey and Hy will be zero. In z direction it is propagating, Ez and Hz will be zero. Next one is, all the E and H components will be perpendicular to the direction of propagation. This is what I have mentioned in this particular slide. Okay. So next one is, next slide is, we are going to talk about your parallel plane wave, right? So we are going to talk about your next important topic is your waves between parallel plane. So what is called as the waves between parallel plane? So if you take a parallel plane, or a parallel plane means if you keep your hand like this, the top hand and the lower hand acts like two plates. So in between the two plates, if your wave is allowed to propagate inside, that is what we call it as a parallel plane. So in your parallel plane, the side walls will not be there. There will be only two walls, the upper wall and the lower wall. So that is what is represented in your diagram. So if you see in the diagram, the wave is going to propagate in our z direction. Along the y direction and along the zx direction, it is the length and width of your waveguide. So let me explain about the diagram. So let us consider an electromagnetic wave which is going to perfectly going to pass through a parallel plane wave between the two plates along the z direction. So this entire construction, if you see, z direction length is infinitely long and y direction width is infinitely long, but the x direction you have the spacing between the two plates, that is what is the distance between the two plates, it will be going on varying. Okay, so that is only it is represented as x equal to 0 to a. So the spacing between the two parallel plates is going to vary between the formula 0 to a. Okay, so the three important consideration for your parallel plane wave is, along your x direction wave is going to propagate, so there will be variation. Along your y direction it is infinitely long, so there won't be any variation, it is a fixed one. Along your x direction there will be some variation, because in between, if you want, you can vary the spacing between your plates. So x equal to 0 to a can be going on varying. So three things you have to remember: y direction there is no variation, meaning in the entire derivation wherever you see dou by dou y, you can make it blindly as zero. Next, along x direction there is some variation. Along the entire derivation, if you see dou by dou x, it has to be maintained in the derivation. And along the entire derivation, wherever you see dou by dou z, since it is the direction of propagation of the wave, it has to be differentiated and substituted. Understood? Dou by dou y should be made equal to zero, and dou by dou x should be kept as such, and dou by dou z has to be differentiated. Okay, so next is your derivation. So when we are going inside, what is the aim of this parallel plane wave? You want to find out what is the amount of radiation, that is what is the amount of radiation that is going to be carried from one place to another. That is the aim of this particular derivation. Okay, so let us go to the next slide. So here, if you see, the problem is given in your hand. A parallel plane wave is given, and you are asked to find what is the radiation fields of a parallel plane wave. So radiation fields means you have to find the E and H fields. So what we are going to do, this parallel plane wave, we will go and put it in a Cartesian coordinate system. So Cartesian coordinate system has three direction, X, Y, and Z direction. When you place there, along the Z direction, the wave is going to propagate. That is what the diagram shows. Along your Y direction, the width is infinite. So there is no variation, dou by dou Y equal to zero. Along your X direction, the width of your, that is the spacing between your plate is going to vary. That is what was represented in the diagram as X equal to 0 to A. So when the problem is given in your hand, as I said before, always the step number one is writing your Maxwell's four equation. So here, if you see the Maxwell's four equation, del cross H, del cross E, del dot D, and del dot B is being written. So now if you solve all the Maxwell's equation, you will end up with your required answer. So now what I have done here is that del cross H, the first Maxwell's equation, you can see in the left hand side of the slide, we have taken that. In that, I have substituted the value of the wave. So we are telling no one wave is going to propagate inside the Z direction. So the wave can be a sine wave or a cosine wave. So in general, it is a wave. So the wave general format I have represented as capital E equal to E naught into e per j omega t, which means capital E represents the electric field intensity, and the value what we are going to substitute represents the magnitude and the phase part of your electric field intensity. So that E value I am going to substitute in the Maxwell's equation. Okay, so in the Maxwell's first equation, if you see, it is dou E by dou t. So the E what I am assuming for wave, I have to differentiate with respect to time t, because the wave is varying with respect to time. So when I differentiate, left hand side, the third equation says dou E by dou t equal to j omega E. Okay, so that equation, j omega E, I will go and substitute in my Maxwell's first equation. So the Maxwell's first equation now is transformed into del cross H equal to E of sigma plus j omega epsilon. So now you are familiar with the terms. Capital E represents the electric field intensity. Sigma is your conductivity, and epsilon is your permittivity. So similarly, the same way I will try to solve my Maxwell's second equation. Maxwell's second equation is del cross E equal to minus mu into dou H by dou T. Same way, I will substitute a value for the magnetic field. Magnetic field is represented in the right side of this slide. H equal to H naught into E per J omega T, a representation for the wave in the magnetic field. So that H I will differentiate with respect to time, and I will substitute in the second Maxwell's equation. So now what we have done, electric field, I have taken a standard equation for a wave. Magnetic field, I have taken a standard equation for wave. Both of them I have differentiated with respect to time, and both of them I have substituted in Maxwell's first equation and the second equation. When you substitute and take curl on both the sides, you will end up with the equation what you're seeing in the bottom of the slide. We call it as the wave equation of a parallel plane wave. So the wave equation is del square E equal to gamma square E, and del square H equal to gamma square H. So you will be able to see this. Okay, so this is your wave equation. Okay, so what happens is this wave equation only helps you in order to find out the electric and magnetic fields present in your parallel plane wave. So now let us go to the next slide. So now what we have done, I have solved the Maxwell's first equation, second equation, and I have an answer in my hand. So now I am going to take the final answer of solved Maxwell's first equation, and I'm going to expand it in your matrix form. Okay, if you see here, del cross H, if you see here, del cross H equal to J omega epsilon E. So this del cross H in matrix form is standard form, it is written here. So always the first row will be the vector, that is X direction, Y direction, Z direction. Always the second row will be a variation with respect to the particular direction, variation of X, variation of Y, variation of Z. And always the third equation or the third one will be your components. That is Hx, Hy, and your Hz. So this is the standard way of writing the matrix for del cross H. and this J omega epsilon E is expanded in this way. So this expanded form and this expanded form, this and this will be equated. So I am going to equate the various components of your x direction, y direction, z direction. That is what is written in your right hand side of the slide as equation number one. So along your x direction, you have this equation when you expand the matrix, along your y direction and along your z direction. So now I am again reminding you, in the starting of the derivation, we said along your y direction, there is no variation. So when you go on to solve this equation number one, what you will do is this dou by dou y is there now, it will be made as zero. So wherever you have dou by dou y, it can be blindly made as zero because along the y direction, there is no variation because the length is a fixed one. It is a constant one. No variation is going to happen. But this dou by dou z, what you will do, you will differentiate with respect to time because the wave is propagating in your z direction. This dou by dou x will be as such remaining because some variation we said along your spacing 0 to a. Okay, so this is what will happen. So now how you expanded your Maxwell's first equation, the same way you are going to expand your final result of your Maxwell's second equation. That del cross H we have finished. Now we are going to expand the del cross E. So we have expanded in the matrix form and I have expanded in the component form. So again, the matrix and the component will be equated for various x and y and z direction, and the equation is obtained here. So this is for your electric field. The equation one was for your magnetic field. So again, if you see here, wherever dou by dou y is coming, you can make it equal to zero. Wherever dou by dou z is coming, you can differentiate. Wherever dou by dou x is coming, you have to keep it as such, as we cannot differentiate. Okay, so now in the course of the equation, this is what we said, this is a wave equation. This gamma, that rho I have written, na, gamma or rho you can call, it is called as propagation constant. The propagation constant is the standard formula is sigma plus j omega epsilon into j omega mu. So as I said, we are going to make the wave propagate inside a parallel plane wave. Inside the parallel plane wave, it is assumed that it is a free space, vacuum. So it is a non-conducting medium. In a non-conducting medium, your sigma charge will not be there. So J will be zero, your sigma will be zero. So when you substitute sigma equal to zero here, your gamma becomes J omega epsilon into J omega mu. So it is J square. J square is minus one and omega square into mu epsilon. That is what I have written here. Okay. So gamma is equal to root of J square omega square mu epsilon. Or if you take square root on both the sides, you can get it as gamma square equal to this equation. Okay. So now what we have actually done, we have solved the Maxwell's equation. Then I have expanded the Maxwell's first equation and second equation in matrix form, equated the components, and I have six set of equations in my hand as of now. Now, how to propagate? As I said before, z is the direction in which your wave is going to propagate. So wave is going on varying with respect to z direction. So the standard way of representing the variation with respect to z direction is e power minus gamma z. So all the components in all the direction will be having the effect of your z direction. So if you see here, it is going to be represented in e power minus gamma z. So what we are going to do, in the previous equation number one, set of three equation, and equation number two, set of three equation, in all the six equations, what we are going to do, I am going to substitute the value which is represented here. That is hy equal to hy naught into e power minus gamma z, hx equal to hx naught into e power minus gamma z. So if you see here, hy is a full component. Here that hy naught is the magnitude of that full component. E power minus gamma z is your phase part of your full component. So this magnitude and the phase part together forms the entire component hy. The same applies for your hx, hz, ex, ey and your ez. So at this stage, what we are going to do is this hx, hy, ex, ey, ez, the standard way of representing for the flow of the wave propagation in z direction, I am going to substitute in equation number one, this part, and equation number two, this part, and I'm going to see what I get. So when I substitute like that, equation number one gives you this answer. what we did, wherever dou by dou y came, I made it equal to zero. Wherever dou by dou z comes, I will differentiate with respect to z. Wherever dou by dou x comes, I will keep that equation as such. So equation number one becomes like this. Equation number two, after substituting for what is that, hx and ey, I get the answer like this. Equation number three, after substituting, I get the answer like this. Similarly, it is done for the next set of three equations. So now you have new set of values for hx, ex, hy, ey, hz and ez. Okay, so next, if you see here, solving that six set of equations, you get a new set of final six equations. Okay, so now what I'm trying to tell is, the parallel plane wave is kept in a Cartesian coordinate system. Along x direction you have two components, along y direction you have two components, along z direction you have two components. Totally, the Cartesian coordinate system consists of six components. That is the aim of finding in this derivation. What is ex, hx, ey, hy, ez, hz? For that only we have come through this particular process. So here we will tell that according to parallel plane wave, in which direction the wave is propagating, component does not exist. In this concept, in which direction the wave is propagating? Wave is propagating in z direction. So hz and ez will be zero. So you have to find, out of six components, only four components you have to find. What are the four components? Hx, ex, hy, ey. Hz and ez does not exist according to the concept of your parallel plane wave. Okay, uniform plane wave. So now what we have done, we have substituted, we have found all the equations of your hx, ex, hy and ey. So here if you see, this is the this is the equation of hx, this is the equation of hy. So if you see hx expression, final expression, hx is equal to minus gamma by h square dou hz by dou x. So hx is represented in terms of hz, ey is represented in terms of hz, and then if you see the next equation, hy is represented in terms of ez and ex is represented in terms of ez. So if you clearly see, three directions, six components, but two components does not exist due to the concept of uniform plane wave. In which direction wave is propagating, a component does not exist. Ez is the direction of propagation, so ez, hz, hz component we are not at all finding. We are trying to find component in x and component in y direction, that is ex, hx, ey, hy. So all the answers, if you see, will be having the effect of ez and hz component. Understood? So next, if you go to the next slide, this is the summary of your parallel plane wave. So in the last slide, we have completed what is our aim. So aim was to find the components in the various direction, ex, hx, ef, ey and hy. We have found it out and we are summarizing here. So what is the summary? Along the z direction, component does not exist. For your parallel plane wave, out of six component, four components exist, and all those four components are being expressed in your equation. Okay, so now we are going inside a property of a parallel plane wave. So if you see, for a waveguide, normally the basic theory is, in a waveguide losses will not be there. How we are telling that losses will not be there? Because if you see here, wave is going to hit to and fro in the walls of the waveguide, so there will be scattering of energy, dispersion of energy, and the losses will be there. But we are telling, in your waveguide the losses will not be there. The main reason for telling like this is this formula. The entire waveguide is being designed based on a spacing property. The spacing is given as d equal to m lambda divided by 2 cos theta, which is a standard formula. So based on this spacing only, a waveguide is fabricated. So here if you see, the d is nothing but the spacing between the two waves or two plates, and m is a discrete component. It can take a value from 1, 2, 3, etc. Theta is called as the launching angle, from which angle the wave is going to be put inside your waveguide. So that is what I have represented in the diagram. So if you see here, the maximum value what a cos theta can take is -1 to 1. So maximum possible value of cos theta is 1. Okay, so we will take this cos theta as 1. So here only varying parameter is your m. M is called as your discrete number. So it can vary from 1. For now, for example, if I put m equal to 1, what will happen? The spacing between the plate will be lambda by 2 into cos theta. If I put m equal to 2, d will be 2 lambda divided by 2 cos theta. So 2 gets cancelled, means it is lambda by cos theta. So based on the variation of n, the spacing also varies. So if you see here, d is directly related with your number m. So that m represents the modes. So what we are trying to tell is, with different values of m, different launching angles can be found out, and different configurations you can get it in a parallel plane wave. So when such thing is happening, the concept is called as modal propagation. So for different values of m, you are able to get different configuration of your parallel plane wave. That is what we call it as your modal propagation. That concept is called as your modes. Okay, so now what is a mode? So mode is nothing but different combinations of traveling of your wave inside a particular waveguide is called as your mode. So for variation in m value, your modal values will be going on changing. So there are three types of modes existing in your parallel plane wave. So just now we have seen a general derivation for a parallel plane wave. What we have done is, we have found out what is EX expression, EY expression, HX expression, and HY expression. Okay, so based on that, we are telling, now in your parallel plane wave, the wave can be transmitted in three different ways. So the three different ways are called as transverse electric field, transverse magnetic field, and transverse electromagnetic field. So we call it as TE wave, TM wave, and TEM wave. So in our next concept, we are going to see in depth what is called as your transverse magnetic field in a parallel plane wave. Okay, so now if you see the word transverse, always remember, when the word transverse is coming and any word is coming next to transverse, that component does not exist. So if you see here, the heading is transverse magnetic field, meaning magnetic field does not exist along the propagation of your wave. Okay, but here, since we have used transverse magnetic, magnetic field does not exist, but the electric field will be existing along the direction of the wave. So the heading what we are going to concentrate now is transverse magnetic field in parallel plane wave. So the same diagram we are going to take here. So the same diagram of your parallel plane wave, that is, along the z direction the wave is going to propagate. Along the y direction, it is an infinite long distance, so it is a fixed one. Along your x direction, the spacing is going to vary. Okay, so what do you mean by transverse magnetic? Transverse magnetic means, along the direction of propagation, that magnetic component alone does not exist, meaning Hz alone does not exist, but Ez will be existing. Okay, so if you see the definition, you see here, the field configuration with no components of magnetic field in the direction of propagation, Hz equal to 0, is called as transverse magnetic wave. But electric component wave exists. That is why it is also called as E waves. M does not exist. E is existing along the direction of propagation. So when E is existing, we call it as E waves. When M is not existing, we use the word transverse along with the M. So it is called as transverse magnetic wave. Okay, so here, this derivation is just the continuation of your parallel plane wave general derivation. Okay, so now what we are going to do is, already we know, if you take a parallel plane wave, six components will be there. Okay, so what are the six components? EX, HX, EY, HY, EZ, HZ. Okay, so out of this, we have to now fine tune what are the various components existing. Okay. Okay. So let us see about the topic transverse magnetic field. This is very, very important. Always keep in mind there are six components. Based on the heading, we are trying to reduce the number of components and we are going to solve the problem. So problem given in your hand is transverse magnetic wave. So six components are there. What components does not exist is what we are going to find now. So transverse magnetic means HZ does not exist. So out of six component, one goes off. Only five components you need to find now. In that also, how much is going to exist or not exist, we are going to find from the final result of the previous derivation what we have done. In the previous derivation, we have seen we have four components, Hx, Ex, Hy, and Ey. In that, if you go and substitute E, Hz equal to zero, that is the main definition of this transverse magnetic field. What happens? See here. First equation of your final answer of parallel plane wave was Hx equal to minus gamma by h square into dou Hz by dou x. When you substitute Hz equal to zero, Hx becomes zero. So the second component Hs is becoming zero. Next in the Ey, if you substitute Hz equal to zero, again Ey becomes zero. So out of six components, three components are getting ruled out. What are the three components getting ruled out? That is based on definition Hz is not existing. By substituting in the final answer of the parallel plane wave derivation, Hx goes off, Ey goes off. So only existing components in your parallel plane wave will be the next three components, that is your Ez, Ex, and Hy. So this is what you have. So aim of the derivation is out of six components, you have to find only three components as such. The three components what you have to find is Ex, Ez, and your Hy. Okay, so now what we are going to do is from the previous equation, I am forming a, what is that? I am forming a second order differential equation. That is, if you see here, I have taken the wave equation. In that wave equation, dou by dou y goes zero. Dou by dou x is there. Dou by dou z is differentiated. You get an equation like this. That is dou square hy by dou x square plus h square into hy. This equation looks like a second order differential equation. So the solution for a second order differential equation in a standard form is written like this. Hy equal to C3 into sin Hx plus C4 into cos Hx. The C3 and C4 is a constant, arbitrary constant. You can use any alphabet. It can be any alphabet. Okay. So now what we are going to do is I have to find what is the value of C3 and C4. And if I substitute here, one component I can find. Okay. So now what is the problem is the equation I'm having, I have to write the boundary condition and I have to find the arbitrary constant C3 and C4. But with magnetic field, I cannot find a boundary condition because the skin effect says that the entire current flows on the surface of the conductor according to skin effect. Entire current, current means it is magnetic field. So magnetic field is existing on the surface of the conductor. So you cannot write a boundary condition with your magnetic field Hy. So this Hy has to be converted into an electric field and then you can write the boundary condition. So what I have to do? This Hy equation, I have to convert it into either Ex or Ez and then I have to solve the problem. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to convert Hy into Ez using this equation. This equation I have taken from the final answer of your parallel plane wave. If you see the derivation once again, you will understand what we have done. Okay, so in this equation, instead of Hy, if I substitute this solution, it will be differentiated and I will get an answer like this. In this, I am going to apply the boundary condition. So what I have done, Hy, I have converted into a solution known as Ez. Now on the surface of the conductor, electric field is zero. So what I will do is, you have the conductor like this, the top surface is at a distance of A, x equal to A, the lower surface is at a distance of x equal to zero. So the boundary condition is Ez equal to 0 at x equal to A and Ez equal to 0 at x equal to 0. Okay, so two boundary conditions we have. So one by one, I am going to apply the boundary condition and get the corresponding arbitrary constant and substitute in your equation and you will get the component what you need. Okay, so here I am substituting the first arbitrary boundary condition, that is Ez equal to 0 at the lower conductor x equal to 0. When you substitute NC, you will get your CP to be equal to 0. When you apply the second boundary condition, E is equal to 0 at x equal to ua, that is the upper planes boundary condition, you will get the next answer. You can solve and see, you will get this answer. That is, when you solve, sin h will be equal to 0, ha will be equal to sin inverse of 0. What is sin inverse of 0? The standard form is n pi. Here I am using the term m pi. Okay, so m is a integer and m pi is the value for your sin inverse of 0, and you get the equation. So C3 equal to 0 and H equal to M pi by A, I will substitute in this equation of EZ and your HY. So you will get the two component EZ and HY, and from the final solution of your parallel plane wave, you can get the third component also. So now by substituting, you get all the values of the needed components of your transverse magnetic wave. So for what are the three existing components of the transverse magnetic wave? It is EX, HZ and your HY. So all the answers we have got. So this is the component, radiative component existing for a transverse magnetic field. Okay. So here if you see in the exponential, you have a component known as gamma. So gamma can also be replaced with a term known as beta. How it can be replaced is, you all know gamma is equal to alpha plus j beta. Okay, alpha is known as attenuation, beta is known as the phase part. When attenuation is not there, only the wave is propagating, what happens? Alpha will be zero, beta will be existing. So gamma can be written as j beta. So wherever gamma is there, when the wave is propagating in either direction, you can replace your gamma with j beta. So the previous equation, this one, or this equation, both are same. Only thing is I have replaced with the phase part. So next one is, just to make you understand, just like a recap, what we have studied till now. In a TM mode, in the Z direction, if the wave is propagating, then which component will be zero? As we said, transverse magnetic means magnetic component in Z direction will be zero. So the answer is HZ equal to zero. For a parallel plane wave guide, the dominant mode is called as TM1. Okay. So next one is, what is the characteristics of a TE mode? So TE means, you can guess, it is transverse electric wave. So transverse electric means EZ will be equal to zero. So the answer is EZ equal to zero. What is the value of intrinsic impedance in a free space? That is, I am asking the value of eta. In the very first slide, we have seen eta is equal to 377 ohms. That is the answer. So here there is a small problem using the formula, that is eta equal to root of mu by epsilon. So here if you see, the permittivity epsilon value is given, permeability the mu value is given, and you are asked to find the wave impedance eta or intrinsic impedance eta. Eta equal to E by H or root of mu by epsilon. When you solve it, you get the answer to be 188.5 ohms. Okay. So now the unit 4 topic is over. So now we are going to jump into the unit 5 topic, waveguide. So waveguide is a familiar concept what we have already seen in the unit 1. What is a waveguide? Waveguide is a hollow metallic tube of uniform cross section from top to bottom. So from top, from the source to the bottom, that is destination, if it is a rectangle, it will be a rectangle. If it is a square, it will be a square, and it will be hollow. Inside, it will be a vacuum only. In that vacuum space only, the wave is allowed to propagate inside. So here, I have given the definition. It is a hollow metallic tube of uniform cross-section, taking your electromagnetic wave with a successive 2 and 4 reflection inside the waveguide to the particular destination. What are the main characteristics of waveguide? If you see, it is bulky, heavy, expensive, but it has very less losses. Because we have already seen, losses are very less or zero in case of waveguide because of adjusting the spacing between the waveguide in a perfect manner based on a formula D equal to m lambda by 2 cos theta. What are the advantages? It is very easy to manufacture. It has very low losses. Handling is very, very easy in case of waveguide. So there are many types of waveguide. In your day-to-day life, you are always seeing a lot of waveguide. In your rooftop, you have a, what is that? A dish antenna. In that dish antenna, you have a torch-like thing, which is going to be projected on the dish. that torch is called as your circular waveguide. Okay, so in your day-to-day life, you are seeing a lot of waveguides which are used for carrying your communication information from one place to another place. So broadly, there are five types of waveguide that is mentioned here: rectangular waveguide, circular waveguide, elliptical waveguide, single ridge waveguide, and double. But in your unit 5, we are going to concentrate mainly on two types only, that is your rectangular waveguide and your circular waveguide, that is this rectangle and your circle one. Okay, so today's class we are going to see the basic derivation of a rectangular waveguide. So I will make this session very, very, very simple for you by telling a small difference between a parallel plane wave and your rectangular waveguide. So if you see here the diagram of your rectangular waveguide, it is same as that of your parallel plane wave. Are you able to see what is the small difference? In your parallel plane wave, along the z direction, the wave was propagating. Same thing here, along z direction, wave is propagating. Along your x direction, what was there? The spacing, 0 to a. Here also, it is 0 to a. Along your y direction, there we said it is infinitely long. So it is a constant, dou y is 0. But in case of rectangular waveguide, you have a side wall. So along your y direction also, it is fixed. And the spacing is 0 to b. So if you see that, what is that? If you see your diagram clearly now, having that difference in your mind, see here, along z direction, wave is propagating. Along x direction, the length of the mouth of the waveguide variation 0 to a. Along your y direction, the spacing variation 0 to b. So now you can easily guess and tell with me, what are the three things? Along z direction, wave is propagating. Along x direction, there is variation, so dou x will be existing. Along your y direction, there is a variation, dou y will be existing. But in parallel plane wave, we said dou y is 0. But in rectangular waveguide, dou y exists. In your wave, you cannot make it equal to 0. That is the only difference. So same derivation of parallel plane wave you are going to do here. So only difference is, wherever dou y is there, you should not make it 0. You will have it along with you throughout the derivation. Understood? That is the only difference. If you remember the difference, the derivation is same. Concept is almost the same with a small variation. So here if you see, the derivation is same as that of your parallel plane wave. Only difference is, in your parallel plane wave, this dou y did not travel with you. But in your rectangular waveguide, this dou y is a varying component. So it will travel along with you till the end of the derivation. Understood? So same derivation you're going to do. Let me go to the final answer. If you go and see the answer, same thing. In which direction the wave is propagating, in that direction component does not exist according to the concept of your uniform plane wave. In rectangular waveguide also, the wave is propagating along the z direction. So EZ, HZ is 0. So out of 6 components, if you see here, we have written only 4 components. That is the reason. Because for a uniform plane wave, along the direction of propagation, component does not exist. EZ, HZ is 0. But its effect will be seen in the other two directions. So if you see here, you have EX, HX, EY, HY. So are you able to see the difference? In your parallel plane wave, you have only this part. What I'm circling and showing, this part alone you had in your parallel plane wave result. But in your rectangular waveguide, you are having dou y also with you. This is the only difference and the main difference between your parallel plane wave and your rectangular waveguide. So as a nutshell, let me tell you what we have seen till now. We have seen what is Maxwell's equation. Then we have taken a parallel plane wave. We have applied the uniform plane wave concept. We tried to find the 4 components existing for a general parallel plane wave. Then we took a configuration of a parallel plane wave. What is the configuration? We took transverse magnetic field and we found what are the components existing and what are the components not existing. Then we have entered into our unit 5. I have shown you what is a rectangular waveguide. In rectangular waveguide, only difference is same parallel plane wave with a side wall. So y direction also, it is varying. It is a defined one. So dou by you cannot make it equal to zero in rectangular waveguide, but you can make it zero in your parallel plane wave. Okay, understood. So if you keep your rectangular waveguide final answer and your parallel plane wave final answer, you can clearly see the difference. So this is all about your rectangular waveguide. So from this